Favor.
Yeah. I need a lift. The Aleutians. Bogoslav Island.
Bogoslav Island? Yeah. Watch, there's nothing out there.
Oh, yeah, there is. There's this. Come here. I found the remains of an encampment from an expedition to a guy named Lamparus. Well, this was there. Preserved in the ice.
Lahoo?
French explorer, 1785. Now, this in Latin, probably written by his priest, because I had 2 years of pre-med Latin, and it's a map. This shows the location of Kiwani. I'm gonna find it.
Kiwani is a myth. Like Atlantis, the fountain of youth, it doesn't exist.
This priest thought so. He saw it. Look at this. Taurus Nitentes Smaragdini, shimmering emerald towers. Won't you come with me? What do you say?
In learning 4, we learn that when I say I'm willing to be in peace of mind right now, and then taking the actions necessary to reduce the stress distraction in my body, I can release my body from my thinking and know myself again as a mind. A mind that knows the upset is inside me and not being done to me by something or someone outside me in the world. By taking these steps, I've successfully disabled the stress component of the willing distraction defense program. I'm not responding as a body on automatic pilot, and I'm most definitely thinking another way. And this won't have gone unnoticed to my wrong mind.
We are We'll show you the way. Yeah, I'll show you the way.
Foster, listen to yourself. The old woman, the stone of St. Sebastian. What is this? Holy Grail King Arthur?
Well?
You ever notice they should never tell you where to go? Turn left, turn right. If you hit the big rock, you've gone too far.
Yes, well, say what you will, but you know you wanted to come.
No. I came just to keep you from becoming a popsicle for some polar bear.
Wait a minute. Are you telling me you're not the slightest bit curious? I mean, you don't get goosebumps thinking we might make some incredible discovery out here. It'd be like stumbling into King Tut's tomb or unearthing Pompeii. Come on. You're not excited by that possibility at all.
What has happened to you?
Just as O'Connell notices how having a purpose has shifted the way Flashman thinks, having my purpose means I'm reacting less and less to my external experiences. I'm going outside in more and more. Now, when I say I'm willing to be in peace of mind right now and relax my body, I feel better. I'm not distracted by the stress feelings in my body in this moment. I'm not stressed out at all. I feel good. And wrong mind sees that as a threat. But UReGO has a program response for this, too. UReGO will now attempt to distort my thinking with the Bliss Distraction Defense Response. Reducing stress is a step in the reality reline practice, and feeling better in this moment is a bonus. But it's not my purpose. When I feel good, Bliss Distraction responds by telling me I could feel even better, and that feeling better will help my purpose. And once I listen to that voice, I won't be saying to myself the last parts of step 3 and attaining an awareness of peace of mind. Instead, I'll be off seeking some amazing feeling, which means I'm back trying to change things in order to have a perfect experience. an experience that lives up to my ideal of what I think is perfect. When I'm thinking like this, I remind myself it only seems like a perfect experience because the voice in my mind is telling me that it will be. It's telling me
I know what I'm looking for.
And whatever that ideal experience, whatever ideal feeling or ideal state of consciousness the voice in my mind is telling me
I am looking for,
it most certainly isn't what I'm experiencing, feeling or conscious of right now. So something has to change to attain that ideal. I think another way.
Did you hear about that woman who walked around the world? Took her 3 years. Wonder how many pairs of shoes she went through. Is that a lodge out here?
Well, maybe we can get a hot meal.
I wouldn't mind a massage. What do you say?
Very weird. Let's go down.
When I say to myself, there is nothing about this moment I want to change, it means I don't want a hot meal or a massage. Right now, in this moment, I simply don't want to change anything. By saying to myself, there is nothing about this moment I want to change, I release any remaining analysis or judgment about this moment from my thinking. And there is nothing about this moment I want to change. Simply because this moment is perfect, just the way it is. When I can think that thought, that right now, this moment is perfect, just the way it is, and hold that thought and think nothing else, I'm in peace of mind. When I'm not telling myself a story about why this moment is or isn't perfect, when there's no voice in my mind having an opinion about this moment, when my mind is completely quiet, I'm in peace of mind. Later, I'll talk you through the Reality Remind as a guided meditation for you to have an awareness of peace of mind. But first, we're going to take a detour to look at the types of experience I'm programmed to expect.
Or rather,
what is the experience I've been programmed to seek? The seeking of which gives me the external validation that I'm doing it right. I remind myself I'm not programmed to experience peace. My wrong mind knows absolutely nothing about peace. I'm programmed for something else.
I'm programmed to want an experience I can feel good about.
That's putting it mildly. Actually, I'm programmed to want an experience that will amaze me.
I'm programmed to want this experience.
Like I was looking at these thoughts from another perspective, and I wondered, who is it that's aware that I'm thinking? And suddenly, I was thrown into this expansive, amazing feeling of freedom from myself, from my problems. I saw that I was bigger than what I do. I was bigger than my body. I was everything and everyone. I was no longer a fragment of the universe. I was the universe.
Wrong mind knows I'm seeking peace, and as I begin to still my mind using some meditation or stress reduction practice, I will react to upsets less and less, which deprives you of fuel. And if I persist in my seeking for peace, shutting down more of those repeat offender fuel stations, in time UReGO will adapt. UReGO's eventual response will be to give me the experience of oneness, the state of being one with everything.
Every dimension was in his grasp.
Come with me. Poetry.
And the goddess rained gifts of forgiveness down on him.
It is an amazing experience. Like, all my pleasure centers got turned on at the same time.
Take the best orgasm you ever had, multiply it by 1,000, and you're still nowhere near it.
I think another way. This isn't revelation. This isn't God or reality. This is the Bliss Distraction Defense Response. Also known as Samadhi to a Hindu yogi, or Nirvana to a Buddhist. The dictionary calls it meditative absorption, the experience of merging into the object of meditation. And science's impressive sounding words for this state are cognitive ecstasy.
The feeling is amazing.
Now, given what I've been learning from A Course in Miracles about God, I must ask myself, does an expansive, amazing feeling of oneness with the universe, does being one with everything physical, still sound like God to me? And would a loving God give me the amazing feeling of this oneness experience, and then leave me in a frustrated state to seek and do not find?
I was no longer a fragment of the universe, I was the universe. And ever since that day, I've been trying to get back there.
And let's be clear, I may have put in the work to still my mind, but I didn't find this experience. It was given to me for a few moments and then taken back.
And suddenly I was thrown into this expansive, amazing feeling.
And now I'm done for. I'm going to spend the rest of my life trying to re-experience that feeling again.
It's as if I've taken love heroin and now I can't ever have it again.
Ever since that day, I've been trying to get back there.
This would be considered a successful application of the UReGO Bliss Distraction Defense Response. Usually, one application is sufficient to distract me for the rest of this dream game. But if I'm persistent, UReGO will give me this experience more and more. But the result will be the same. Blissing out feels great, better than great, but I get nothing done. I'm not living a normal life. I'm separating myself from everyone. I'm being special. I'm being very special indeed. And the effect this experience has on me is to turn my thinking back to front. Now I'm going to repeat over and over into the future the practices that seem to bring me this experience of bliss in the past.
I'm looking to the past to see how I want it to be in the future.
I'm actually wanting what happened in the past to be my experience in the future. And as I practice the reality of mind and bring my upsets to peace, it's quite likely that UReGO may give me these blissful experiences. But I don't want them. They're a momentary distraction that, at best, end up in weeks of depression, because my actual life experience could never live up to that ideal high, which I'm now desperate to re-experience. Wrong mind tells me I earned it by my hard work, by my suffering. And to have that momentary reward again, I must work harder. So I look to the past to see how to behave so I might receive my reward in the future.
Change my way of thinking. Make myself a different set of rules.
Practicing the reality remind changes the way I think about the life I have and the way I think about the people in it. It doesn't require I withdraw from my present life to live a separate life in order to further seek and hopefully re-experience this bliss distraction.
I could really get used to this. No phone. No digging out of the driveway. No 4 a.m. flights to Sitka. Even you, Flashman, we haven't had an argument. You realize that in how many days?
Josh.
Flashman, how many days have we been here?
3, I think. Difference doesn't make.
So what happened to, whatchamacallit? Kiwani.
Uno mas.
No, wait. Flashman, what about Kiwani, the jeweled city of the north?
I'm gonna get us some more drinks.
Bad. This is bad, Flashman. Hey, Flashman. I used to love to fly in the morning. You know, I could see the sun coming up. And you, a week ago, all you could think about was finding Kiwani. Now you're strung out on some shiatsu massage. We have got to get out of here. We got to get out of here right now.
I don't want to get out of here, okay? I like it here. It's fun.
Well, yes, of course it's fun. It's fun because we're wallowing around in this herbal-scented bliss, but don't you see maybe that's the problem?
Dr. Fleischman, time for your algae wrap.
No, he doesn't want it.
Yes, I do.
No, you don't. Fleischman, listen, don't you remember the sirens? How they'd sing their beautiful songs and the sailors couldn't resist them and they'd crash their boats on the rocks and die?
What?
I don't know, but look, this search, I feel like it's something you're supposed to do. Okay? Come on.
Tashiyano, that's the treasure.
I begin to see some of the ways seeking this very special experience has determined many of the choices I've made.
Choose DIY and wondering who the fuck you are on a Sunday morning. Choose sitting on that couch watching mind-numbing, spirit-crushing game shows, stuffing fucking junk food into your mouth.
Choose Facebook, Twitter, Snapchat, Instagram, and 1,000 other ways to spew your bile across people you never met. Choose updating your profile. Tell the world what you had for breakfast and hope that someone somewhere cares.
I chose not to choose life. I chose something else. And the reasons? There are no reasons. Who needs reasons when you've got head on?
You know, I'm thinking that maybe you got it right. There's the dragons, the sirens, the sushi.
Now, sushi?
Yeah, because in the traditional hero's journey paradigm, you slay a dragon, you get a boon, right?
Yeah, but sushi?
You know, when I was a kid, I remember thinking that nothing was real. I remember it like all felt like a movie set, you know, and if you turn your head fast enough, you catch God or something changing the scenery.
Yeah, I know what you mean.
I still have that feeling. It's like a sense that there's this whole other reality, you know? That this real reality, but we can't see it. I guess that's why I became a doctor. When I think about it, that's why I went to medical school. You know, to get some answers. Maybe in the blood, in the bones, heart. Didn't happen, though. Still don't know what reality is. So, then how do we know what's possible and what isn't? Hey. My whole life has been leading to this point.
Maybe I'll get my chance to look behind the curtain.
Or we will.
Look. If you had one shot, one opportunity to seize everything you ever wanted, one moment that you captured, just let it slip.
Come on out here. Come on, everybody out. I want you to take a moment and look around and tell me what you see or what you hear. Okay? All right. Lorraine.
Cars. Honking cars.
Good. Natalie.
Jackhammers.
Anybody else?
Stoplights.
Stoplights.
Cement.
A homeless person.
Trash.
Middle fingers.
Good. Excellent. Now, remember that. Follow me. All right, now what do you see? All right?
The ocean.
Good.
Trees.
Space needle.
Skyscrapers.
Mount Rainier.
Rivers.
Beautiful rivers.
Sun.
All right.
Naked hot tubber.
Wow. A little bit different up here, isn't it? And yet, it's the same. We haven't gone anywhere. We're just looking at things from a new perspective. Inside of each of you, there are sirens, honking horns, and gridlock. But there's also this. We just have to do the work and climb the stairs to find it.
If I think another way about my split mind, I can think of the thought of peace as the HS1 direct phone line. I have two cell phones, HS1 right mind cell phone, and you'll go wrong mind cell phone. HS1 cell phone sees, hears, and feels everything that your go phone sees, hears, and feels. The difference is HS1 sees it like this. This is my experience when I'm on my UReGO phone, a body in the world, perceiving and interpreting the signals I'm receiving on the battleground. And this is my experience when I'm in peace, observing myself on HS1 phone, above the battleground. These phones run on different frequencies, on different networks, and use different programming languages. It's not possible to transfer any information between them, and never will be possible. HS1 phone can see what I'm experiencing on my UReGO phone, because both phones are in my mind. And HS1 knows all my mind. UReGO doesn't even know HS1 phone exists. And I can either be on one phone or the other, but I can't use them both at the same time. Ever. I can use all the functions and applications of the UReGO phone and communicate with anybody else who has their own UReGO phone. But HS1 phone has no functions or applications. It can't even receive a call. It has no controls. It's simply a direct line to my right mind. It connects me instantly to Holy Spirit every time my mind is in the awareness of peace. And I stay connected as long as I'm in peace of mind. I have to be absolutely clear with myself. To be in peace of mind, I have to know I'm a mind. I can't still be thinking I'm a body. This is my wrong mind cell phone in normal consciousness. It's running UReGO applications which interpret the signals my phone receives into my senses. So I can touch, taste, see, hear, and smell. Everything I use to define my experience of myself as a body in the world. My wrong mind phone is networked to UReGO telling station, which generates the signals for everybody's phone. In a sense, bliss is when my consciousness has gone back up the T3 optics line to UReGO telling station, and my mind is absorbed into the consciousness of the UReGO telling station. In normal consciousness, I'm limited to experiencing myself through the applications of my wrong mind phone. Now I'm experiencing the code that makes up my wrong mind phone. This is the source code of the entire dream game world. This code isn't like the wrong mind phone signals that need me to be upset and put me under stress all the time, so I'll keep thinking I'm a body. This code isn't based on I'm not enough. This code is based on I'm everything. This code feels good. Source code is bliss compared to wrong mind phone signals. This code is friendly.
Hello? How are you? Have you been alright through all those lonely, 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 lonely nights? That's what I'd say. I'd tell you everything.
If you'd pick up that telephone. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So as far as my wrong mind is concerned, I've returned to the source of its existence. I'm one with the generator of the signals that make up the dream game I'm playing. To wrong mind, I'm home.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Hey. In UReGO telling station consciousness,
how you feeling?
I'm not a body anymore.
Are you still the same? Don't you realize the things we did were all for real, not a dream,
I'm reading source code.
I just can't believe.
At the source.
They've all faded out of view.
And what source code tells me is that I'm everything. And wrong mind definitely prefers that.
And suddenly, I was thrown into this expansive, amazing feeling of freedom. I was the universe.
So whether I'm suddenly thrown into that amazing feeling of oneness and feel free for a few moments, or spend years in a blissed out state totally absorbed by I'm everything consciousness, I still won't find what I'm looking for.
Look into the sky. The love you need ain't gonna see you through. And I wonder why the little things you find they call me true.
How blissful it seems and reassuring the voice telling me I'm everything. There is no awareness of God's peace here. There is no awareness of the presence of love here at all. Here, there is no seeking anything. I'm one with everything. The source. I'm blissed out reading source code in the CPU. From this state of consciousness, the idea of being a separate, wrong mind phone running applications on a limited, perishable body is not a consciousness I will choose to return to willingly. That's game over for me.
The number you have dialed is not in service at this time.
I've been all over this island. It's nothing but rock.
Well, stew's ready.
Did you hear me? I have no idea what this should be. Chris Gentis, I don't know. We're dead in the water. We're dead.
I hear you.
That's all. No reproach, huh? I told you so. I knew this was going to happen. No, I can't believe you led me on a wild goose chase. Nothing like that.
I don't have any regrets, Lodgman. I'm actually enjoying myself.
I know what you mean.
So I think another way about seeking oneness, or bliss, or attaining I'm everything consciousness. Because when I think another way, I see that even just the one experience of the amazing feeling of oneness will usually cause severe depression, as Mr. Carey knows well.
And, you know, I dealt with depression, you know, a few years ago, and people still think, well, he's going through, you can tell he's depressed. It's not. I have no depression in my life whatsoever. Literally none.
Continuing to think of this depression-inducing amazing feeling as an ideal will keep me stuck thinking I'm not enough. To get unstuck, I think another way. I turn my inside-out, fear-based thinking outside in.
Our eyes are not viewers. They are also projectors that are running a second story over the picture that we see in front of us all the time. Fear is writing that script. Now, fear is going to be a player in your life, but you get to decide how much.
You can spend your whole life imagining ghosts, worrying about the pathway to the future, but all there will ever be is what's happening here. And the decisions we make in this moment, which are based in either love or fear.
Fleischman? Hey. Fleischman, wake up. Wake up. Hey, what was that word?
Word?
Yeah, that thing that you were looking for on the map. What was it?
Crescentes. Or I think it was Crescentes, because the last few letters were smudged. What?
Crescentes, because I just had the most vivid dream. And in the dream, I was in Paris with this guy that I used to be a student with at the Sorbonne, Jean-Marc. And we were buying all this stuff for breakfast.
What are you talking about?
Well, you said the guys who wrote the map were French, right?
Yeah.
Well, doesn't Crescentes sort of sound like croissant?
You see, the thing I've noticed about the Holy Spirit is when you get guidance, it comes in really fast.
Yes.
Whoa.
What?
I just got an idea about what might be wrong with Bonnie.
And it's like it's a big picture rather than a bunch of words.
Draw a croissant between the two marks. Like this. There.
Whoa! Whoa! Ho!
That's it.
X marks the spot.
Numbers.
Stock market, New York composite. In just a sec. GM's gone below its low. Gotta make a buy.
Wow. Not waiting for this voice to come through my head and it says, oh, you know, thou shalt do this.
It's a good idea.
You get a picture.
Tony, you did a good job. Basically, you are right.
And it's very quick, and it's very quiet, but you have to be in a place where you can hear it, because this is happening on all the time. So this is where it has to be quiet.
Close your eyes. What do you hear?
I hear the water. I hear the birds.
Do you hear your own heartbeat?
No.
Do you hear the grasshopper, which is at your feet?
Old man, how is it that you hear these things?
Young man, how is it that you do not?
And you build that portal.
This is amazing! Can I have it in writing?
It is already written. In the sinews of history and the hearts of men.
So from now on, it's about practicing being in peace of mind and locating my peace portal.
And that means doing the steps over and over, like a drill.
Blue line back, red line back, far blue line back, far red line back. And you have 45 seconds to do it. Get used to this drill. We'll be doing it a lot. Why? Because the legs feed the wolf, gentlemen.
Be prepared to grow through pain, gentlemen. You're going to skate harder than you've ever skated in your life. Every minute of every day you're on the ice with... Come on, go, boys, go, boys! The fastest way to make this team is by being fast.
If when I say there is nothing about this moment I want to change, the voice in my head insists there most certainly is something that needs to be changed, then I identify the cause of this upset. If I'd like to change the traffic noise or my shoes are uncomfortably tight, then I go back and do steps one and two on this upset. I'm never upset for the reason I think I am. It's not the traffic or my shoes. Every upset is an unconscious reminder I'm not at home in peace. There is no separation in reality. I decide for peace. I'm willing to be in peace of mind right now. There's nothing about this moment I want to change. The traffic is the way it is. I can either choose to come to peace with my shoes being tight or simply decide to take them off. If I think turning the lights down or sitting on the floor will make it easier to relax, then I do it. I change what I can. I don't fight myself. Suffering has no part in a perfect moment. When there's nothing I want to change, I say this moment is perfect, just the way it is. And if the voice has some opinion about this moment not being perfect, then I identify that upset and do the steps again. I keep repeating this until I hear no opinions. And when there is no voice, I'm in peace of mind. And once in peace, my mind naturally slips into an awareness of this moment. I'm at my peace portal. Once the peace portal is located, inhabited, and energized, I can go there in an instant. Then it will be time to add the hoop practice. Then we'll look at what is keeping me from having this awareness when I've got my eyes open and doing stuff out in the world. I can hardly stop, close my eyes, take deep breaths, and go through this every time I get upset out in the world. This is a practical course. The complete practice from first noticing to flicking the switch and going to my peace portal, then handing over the unconscious cause of the upset to Holy Spirit, and back to peace of mind, takes 5 seconds. Less time than it took me to describe it. And I don't have to close my eyes. I don't have to stop what I'm doing. I'm not changing my behavior. I'm changing the way I think about my behavior. No one else can even tell what I'm doing. It's only Holy Spirit that even knows I'm thinking another way. And other than a few moments with the rather distant look in my eyes, no one is aware of what's going on at all. But for me, where just a moment before I was becoming upset, I'm now peacefully aware of the situation and taking the best advice. All in an instant. Now that's a miracle.
5 seconds left in the game. Do you believe in miracles? Yes!
When I'm not telling myself a story about why this moment is or isn't perfect, when there's no voice in my mind having an opinion about this moment, when my mind is completely quiet, I'm in peace of mind. And as my mind remains quiet, my conscious experience will naturally shift or gently slide into an awareness of the moment. Like the focus of my attention slides from watching the screen in front of me to observing myself and the screen from above and behind. From this perspective, I'm observing myself watching the screen. I don't have an opinion about what I'm observing. I'm not thinking I want to change anything, because this moment is perfect, just the way it is. I'm no longer experiencing with my body's senses. I'm aware of this moment in my mind. And it's an awareness of this moment as perfect, just the way it is, right now. We're going to attain, right now. So, please follow along with me. I'm seated comfortably, with my spine straight, feet flat on the floor, my shoulders and hands relaxed. I close my eyes. I take a slow, deep breath. I let it out with a sigh. As I breathe in, I count one. As I breathe out, I count two. As I breathe in, I count three. As I breathe out, I count four. As I breathe in, I count five. As I breathe out, I count six. As I breathe in, I count seven. As I breathe out, I count eight. As I breathe in, I count nine. As I breathe out, I count 10. 1. 2. 3. 4. 5. 6. 7. 8. 9. 10. I let my breathing settle. My breath becomes light and shallow. I move my attention from my breath to the top of my head and gently scan down my body from my head to my toes, noticing any discomfort or stress. And I release all discomfort and stress with a silent sigh. I release my body from my thoughts. I quietly remind myself I'm never upset for the reason I think I am. Every upset is an unconscious reminder I'm not at home in peace. There is no separation in reality. I decide for peace. I'm willing to be in peace of mind right now. There is nothing about this moment I want to change. This moment is perfect, just the way it is. And I hold that thought, and I don't think anything else. I'm aware of this moment, just the way it is. When you're ready, please open your eyes. please take a pause and share with your group about your experience of attaining an awareness of the moment. What was it like being in peace of mind, even if it was only for an instant? Or if it seemed like nothing happened at all? And did any opinions or expectations come up to distract me from this awareness?
Here it is. They came over this morning, 7:30, couldn't find it, went up in the attic, went all over the place, went through all the cabinets, nothing. Then another electrician turned up this afternoon that they'd asked to come over, stuck his head in there, pulled it out within 2 minutes. Now, I have no idea how, after I'd emptied all the cabinets at least 3 times, it was in there. It makes no sense, anything like any of this does. You know, the two guys in here this morning, and they were both, you know, opened all the cabinets, looked inside, nothing. So, anyway, there is no more beep, this is it. And, well, I feel like a complete idiot, frankly. I mean, how is it that I couldn't find it after I emptied the cabinet? And it's just in the bottom of that one. I had everything taken out. All that upset, all that crazy turmoil in my head, all over one little beep. And it should have been able, I should have just been able to get rid of it immediately. I feel like an idiot, causing a lot of trouble for other people, getting all paranoid about being under attack. I don't know where to go now. I mean, I just feel like a complete nut. Landlord walked in and said, shame on me. I have no idea how that could have stayed in there and not be found. But there you go. Whatever the lesson is, I'm sure I'll get it more over time. But again, I suppose it reinforces the idea that even though I think I know where it is and I can go find it, I still can't. Whatever the upset is, it's going to be, only Holy Spirit will be able to find it. And fortunately, Holy Spirit sent somebody over to save my sanity this afternoon. I'm relieved that it's been found. Absolutely. I can sleep better tonight. I don't know how I haven't found it before. I mean, I'm sure I've been through those cabinets several times, so either I'm hallucinating my own actions, which may be possible, or it just wasn't going to be found until today, and it's that simple. But I can't for the life of me explain it. I'm just completely befuddled. Doesn't make any sense at all. How could it be in there? None of it makes any sense. Everything's inside out, upside down, back to front.
Do you remember, Arshad? देहरादून की अपनी इंडियन मिलिट्री एकेडमी के चटवुड हॉल के एंट्रेंस में क्या लिखा है?
द सेफ्टी ऑनर एंड वेलफेयर ऑफ योर कंट्री कम फर्स्ट ऑलवेज एंड एवरी टाइम.
सेफ्टी ऑनर एंड वेलफेयर ऑफ योर कंट्री, ये लाइन हम रोज पढ़ते थे अर्शद. लेकिन आज इतने सालों बाद ये बात समझ में आई है कि योर कंट्री, आवर कंट्री, हमारा मुल्क इंग्लैंड नहीं, हिंदुस्तान है.
यार हम अंधे थे क्या अर्शद? सिर्फ बेवकूफ.
Stick with the memories. They're just better.
So you're a shattered man.
That's my youth gone.
And I've got even worse news for you.
Oh, no. Do not tell me that that's a ladyboy.
Her name is Stephen. Stephen.
I realized that the I know I'm right blocks that said I've already emptied all these cupboards, it's not in the cupboard, it has to be somewhere else, made me totally blind and stupid. I don't know how I could possibly miss them and all those other people that looked, but clearly something was blinding me to finding it.
You're telling me this thing will run off my body's energy?
That's how they work.
See? You're humming along already. Okay. Existence. Only from antenna. Here we go.
You got a bit of an unfair advantage, don't you? How can I possibly compete with the designer of the system?
Well, you could beat the guy that invented poker, couldn't you? Look at this. Games I've never heard of.
Wait a minute. That reminds me. What precisely is the goal of the game that we're playing now?
You have to play the game to find out why you're playing the game. It's a future, Michael. You'll see how natural it feels.
Bullseye! You should have hurt yourself. Oh, aside from being a shaman, I don't think there's much you can see in me. Ah!
Who are you?
Who am I? That's good, Ed. That's really good.
So some kind of carnival?
Ed, come on. Look at me. I'm green, I'm short, I have a great sense of humor. Any clues there, huh?
You're a green man.
No, I'm a divot from the 16th tee at Pebble Beach.
You're some kind of evil spirit, aren't you?
Ed. I'm your pal, your buddy, your chum. And I gotta say, you know, I like that jacket.
I gotta go.
Wait. Hey. Ed. I realize we're in this together for the long haul. You and me. Two clams in the sea. Two bugs in the rug. Ed, it's gotta slow down. Have a little consideration for my size.
What do you want?
What do I want? Well, to tell you the truth, I've always wanted to live by the sea. Nothing fancy. A little modest 3-4 bedroom place. Cedar deck out back.
I'm going home.
Wait, hold up. All right. Two confessions. What I really want is to completely incapacitate you with self-doubt, so that eventually you won't have enough inner strength to get yourself up out of a chair. You with me, Ed?
No, I don't understand you.
Self-doubt. I want to fill your life with fear, anxiety, misgivings, the whole 9-course dinner. Speaking of which, how about fistics tonight?
Why are you picking on me?
Oh, you think I asked for this? You think I wouldn't rather be tracking caribou? Remember, you called me.
No, I don't think so.
Oh, Ed, you know how I hate it when we argue. Oh, jeez, I just remembered. I gotta go to the airport to pick up my cousin. He's a troll. He lives right outside of Leipzig. I haven't seen him since the wall came down. Well, hey, I'll catch up with you. Keep dinner warm for me, all right? Take it easy, pal. Oh, I can't wait. It's been so long time. I can't wait.
Where's the best place an opponent should hide?
The very last place you would ever look.
Do you know who Sam Gold is, Mr. Green?
He's pathetic, weakling.
And the single biggest harm is... I am you.
The ego doesn't want you to discover that it isn't you. Please allow me
to introduce myself. I'm only here for one reason. To stop you from making a terrible mistake.
You've heard that voice for so long, you believe it to be you.
You should have taken the stairs. This is a con. Hold on, Jake. This isn't the plan. This won't have a happy ending.
You believe it to be your best friend.
They should believe their opponent to be their best friend.
He's had you your entire life.
It's us against them.
And now you're trying to upset the apple cart by using a different technique to align your mind with the Holy Spirit rather than with the ego.
You're in a game, Jake. You're in the game. Everyone's in its game, and nobody knows it. And all of this is his world. He owns it. He controls it.
I've had enough of this shit. It's starting to do my head in. Tell me I've had enough.
He tells you what to do.
Look, that's enough.
And when to do it.
Tell him.
I said that's enough, Abby!
Eventually, when the opponent is challenged or questioned, it means the victim's investment and thus his intelligence is questioned. No one can accept that. Not even to themselves.
At first it's difficult for the mind to accept that there's something beyond itself, that there's something of greater value and greater capacity for discerning truth than itself.
Do you know who Sam Gold is, Mr. Green? He's all up here, pretending to be you.
It just stayed there, and it bothered me. Now, I'm referring to a conversation that I had with a very close friend of mine, and we were working on a white paper for PricewaterhouseCoopers, and we were thinking about technology, and I said, you know, I'm going to St. Louis, and I'm very excited about it. And so he goes online, and he said, you know, I started on this TEDx St. Louis site, but now I'm just curious. I'm going through all the sites where your bio is posted, including LinkedIn and your own website, julietpowell.com, and you never mention the fact that you were Miss Canada. Why is that? And I said, you're right. It's probably because it's not relevant. I said, what do you mean it's not relevant? It's part of who you are. It's part of what gave you your start. The very thing that got me started is the very thing I never share. And so when my friend brought this to my attention, he followed up with, "Is it because you're ashamed?" And I really, really, really stopped. I really wondered, am I ashamed? And if I am ashamed, why would I be ashamed? Is it because that I've bought into the notion that someone who is considered to be physically attractive can't possibly be intelligent?
Really changed the way that I you know, thought about hypnosis. And also started this, you know, this realization that ultimately my kind of toolkit with what I do is the stories that people are telling themselves. That's really, you know, all there is. Even a magician showing you a card trick is just getting you to tell yourself a story, edit this event in such a way that you go, oh, you know, I picked a card and then it disappeared. And it was in my pocket. He never went near me. And you edit out all the bits that don't seem important, like when he complimented you on your jacket earlier on in the day and may have stuck a card in there, or the bit when he took the card back for a moment, whatever, because you don't, you know, you're being sold a story with particular sort of edit points.
Are you pushing it?
No.
Are you?
No.
Are you?
No.
Are you?
No.
Oh, good. All right, back over here. Take the microphone. You do your trot now. Call it. Come to me.
Come to me.
To me, that's interesting, because that's what life is. You know, we have this infinite data source coming at us, and we have to kind of reduce it to stories to make sense. So I think stripping aside all the kind of vaudeville and tacky associations of hypnotists and magicians and so on, I think there's something interesting at the heart of it. I think that our storytelling capacity is kind of endlessly fascinating to me.
On average, we have about 50,000 thoughts each day. 98% of those thoughts are the same thoughts as we had yesterday, and 80% of those thoughts are negative.
What did I learn from the beeps? Wow. I think I learned that 1,440 beeps a day will take over my mind. You know, it was very hard to ignore that constant input. And it was definitely starting to stress me out and alter the way I think. Now, that is one beep a minute. My wrong mind is sending at least 50,000 messages a day to my mind. And if 1,400 can take over my mind, imagine what 50,000 is doing. How difficult and how overwhelming it is to try and think another way. So,
what's for dinner?
50,000 thoughts a day.
To be on the beach.
At least 40,000 of those are negative or limiting.
There is no wrong mind.
It's not possible. You know, I think the message or the lesson I've learned is it's really not possible to operate outside of those messages. You know, I'm going to keep hearing them. I mean, I can't, you know, most of the 50,000 that are coming at me, you know, I'm not even really listening to them. They're just, you know, you can't do that, it's too fast, go no way, yeah, okay. So, look. You know, it's just constant.
Go.
Never stop.
Run. Eat. Hide.
So,
go back to sleep.
In order for me to actually
say that. I'll never do that.
Be in peace, I have to learn to not listen.
It'll turn out just like last time.
I can't just ignore them. I have to listen to something else. Substitution rather than denial. I have to choose to think another way. I can't just do it automatically.
Don't argue with me. What a disgrace. Don't do that.
I'm right.
No. Where's my dinner? Mustn't forget to watch the news.
These five-year survival rates, it's confusing me. What does that mean? Is that with treatment or without treatment? And if it's with treatment, what does that
mean and what treatment are we talking about? And he goes, let me ask you a question. How many times have you asked these questions or sought the answers to them? A lot. Are you getting any new and different information in your quest? Not really. He says, then I have one word of advice for you, and that is for you to focus your attention on getting closer to God. And if you do that, then everything will be okay. In that moment, I realized that he was not delivering a faith healer's promise. He was in no way assuring me that Nancy was going to live. What he was doing was he was telling me to get out of my head and to venture into the scary place of not knowing. He was telling me to live in my strength, whether I call that God, spirit, courage, or something else. So I started to reflect on that. And I started to reflect on the absentee father and husband that I had been the weeks leading up to that meeting with Dr. Carlos Castillo. How I had been going through the motions of caring for Nancy and thinking that caring came in the form of doing everything that I could to research so that I could fix this particular situation. But in the meantime, I was really overwhelmed with my own fear and my own distress. I know that Nancy and the kids missed me. So I go home, I throw away all the books, I pray when I need to pray, I cry when I need to cry, and I let go of the need to know. Dr. Castillo tells me, and he told me later on, that the number one challenge that he has as an oncologist is getting people to let go of the need to know, getting people to let go of control over something which they have very little or no control over. Now, fortunately, the weeks ahead bring better news, and we find that while Nancy's tumor was nasty, it was small and it was contained. And she sits here with us today.
To my friend on one end, and I'm really thankful to the taxi driver on the other end, who just reinforced the fact that, of course I must be this, or of course I must be that, according to the way that I look. But I don't buy it anymore. I had to be conscious of it.
What you call love was invented by guys like me to sell nylons.
A lot of people, I wouldn't say everybody, but a lot of people think they can't draw. However, there are some key principles, five principles, that you can apply to learning to draw, and you can actually learn to draw in 5 days. So
I had to be conscious of it, but now that I am, I need to start examining every little bit of my life. Every time I make a decision, every time I say something to someone, is that really what I think, or am I just toting the social line, the thing that we all say to each other because it's easier, it's faster, and that's how unconscious bias works. Right, we've got this framework, this pattern in our minds of the way that the world works. And we don't have to think about it on an ongoing basis because we know we've got mental models of how things work. But if your mental model diminishes you or a part of you or shames you, I think it's about time that we change some of our mental models.
Thank you.
started my career as a hypnotist, and I saw this guy performing at university, and I just thought, I'm gonna do that. I didn't realize at the time all these boxes that it was ticking, you know, performing, that sort of, you know, need for affirmation and love and center of attention, and also the control aspect of it, you know, the kind of the control aspect, and also the kind of people, particularly the sort of guys that would respond well to hypnosis and come up on stage and, you know, and respond well to it, tended to be exactly the kind of guys that would have really intimidated me before. So that was like at an unconscious level, and I hope I've grown out of that now, mainly, but it ticked a lot of boxes. So that's how I started. And yeah, I was definitely driven by insecurity, because any sort of magic, which sort of followed for me on from the hypnosis, it is the quickest, most fraudulent route to impressing people. That's, you know, the subtext is only, you know, look at me, aren't I great, which is not that interesting after a while. So I've tried to, you know, as I've grown up, I've tried to move it into a different area, and one that's a little more resonant than just showing off.
And in the 1920s, Sir Arthur Conan Doyle, who was the man that gave us the mastermind of rationalism, Sherlock Holmes, himself became a proud proponent of spiritualism. And in 1924, the same year that he wrote a book proclaiming his belief in fairies, Conan Doyle went to visit a medium who lived in Stepney in East London. And there he witnessed what he later described as the single most convincing and impossible demonstration of table turning that he'd ever seen. The medium that he saw was a man called Albert Macy. Albert Macy, who convinced him, was a fraud. He was a charlatan. He was one of the few mediums to be imprisoned for fake mediumship, as they were in those days.
I was preparing to do the introduction to Learning 4. Learning 4's all finished, and I needed a haircut. I hadn't had a haircut in over 6 months. Looked a bit scruffy. So I found this guy on the internet. My normal hairdresser's closed. He was operating out of his garage, a couple of miles away. Drove over there, sat down. He asked me how I'd like my hair. I said, oh, just give it a good trim, you know, it's got very long, it just needs a good clean up. And the next thing I know is zip, 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 zip. I look down and there's hair this long lying in my lap, big clumps of it. I was kind of in shock, to be honest. And it wasn't until I got home, I mean, the guy actually knew that he, you know, messed up, because he texted me before I even got back to the car. And I did comment, he's like, oh, this is so short. You wouldn't use the machine next time. It wasn't really until I got home and could kind of see myself in the mirror that I realized just how short it was. I mean, it's all skin, you know, it's just skin everywhere. It's a quarter of an inch long at the most. So at that point I got kind of upset, and I wrote a review, which really just kind of highlighted the insensitivity of any barber that would consider somebody who walked in with a full head of, albeit thinning, hair, would want his head shaved without asking. Anyway, I wrote the review, I posted it on Yelp, and summed it up with, this is the worst haircut of my entire life, which, as far as I was concerned, it was. He offered me $100 to take it down. I left it up for 3 days, but I realized I was just getting more and more upset because it's an attack. I mean, no matter what way, you know, I can say I was using it to help other people so they didn't have the same thing happen to them, but the reality was it was an attack. It would hurt his business, it would hurt him. And I took it down after 3 days and immediately felt better.
And what I learned from that particular experience is that we as human beings have a strong desire to make the unknown known as part of our survival mechanism. Why is that? Because the unknown is a scary place. The unknown brings pain, it brings discomfort, and pain and discomfort is associated with death. So in a sense, what we will do is we will tend to stay stuck in the I know and do whatever it is that we can to venture out and accept whatever it is that we don't know. And that's what I was doing in that particular situation, was clinging on to an answer that I knew would be absolutely, positively certain that I would be okay in that particular situation. And this is a big challenge. This is a challenge for us today. When our mind goes into that fearful place of wanting to cling on to what it is that we know. I have a metaphor for that. We call the mind going into a fearful place the drunken monkey. So the drunken monkey is that fearful mind, that fearful way of thinking, that when it gets activated, when it gets going, it starts spewing out all sorts of self-talk. I need to fix this now. You better do this. What happens if this happens? Why did you do that? Or why did I do that? How can I possibly handle this particular situation? And so what had essentially happened to me was I had gotten hijacked by the drunken monkey. Now, there are a couple of things to be aware of as you start to think about that negative self-talk part of our mind, the drunken monkey. One of the things that the drunken monkey likes: simplicity, clarity, and certainty. Simplicity, clarity, and certainty. There's that part of our program that likes to have everything boiled down to something that we can grab onto and say is absolutely and positively true.
Come towards it. Just do me a favor, just move your hand over the top of that. You can see there's nothing attached to it, yes?
No.
Was it Vince or Vincent?
Vincent.
Vincent. He's gone. Let it come back down. Move your hands with it. Move your hands. Let it come down. He's gone. You can let go. He's gone. John, thank you so much.
So much change going on in the world right now. And that change is bringing out so much fear. It's bringing out so many drunken monkeys that people want something that they can hold on to that's absolutely, positively, undeniably true. An ideology, a particular belief. And if the fear is strong enough, they will kill people over that particular idea. So that's the drunken monkey working at its most challenging for what goes on around us in our society.
He's behind all the pain there ever was, behind every crime ever committed.
How can I be behind all the pain, all the crime, if I don't even exist?
And right now, he's telling you that he doesn't even exist. We just put you to war with the only enemy that ever existed. And you, think he's your best friend.
And they will protect their best friend with everything they've got.
The whole point of this course is training your mind to stop thinking that you know best. Because the you that knows best is the ego. And the ego is not your friend. It's not going to bring you what
I
you want.
Fill your life with fear,
it's going to bring you lots
anxiety,
and lots of upsets and frustrations and distractions,
bitter.
All of which are designed to keep you from focusing on the one thing that this is all about.
What happened? What's going on? What happened?
I saw the inner me.
Where's the best place an opponent should hide? In the very last place you'd ever look. He's hiding behind your pain, Jake. Embrace the pain, and you will win this game. How radical are you prepared to be, Mr. Green?
up, so that eventually you won't have enough inner strength to get yourself up out of a chair. You with me, Ed?
You're in a game, Jake.
Oh, I don't understand.
He's the enemy, Jake. Not me.
Everyone's in his game. Use your perceived enemy, and nobody knows, to destroy your real enemy.
Do not listen, Jake.
You've got a gun. Use it!
Your greatest enemy is your own inner perception, is your own ignorance, is your own ego.
What's amazing about that, I think, is despite the fact that it is clearly some sort of conjuring trick, it was enough to convince Conan Doyle of everything he wanted to believe in. Purely because he watched that through the eyes of belief. He was ready to believe. He was prepared to believe anything. And the Oracle Act, I believe, is a great testament to our need to believe. If a man stands on stage, calls himself the Oracle, armed with a few envelopes with initials on them, maybe some bandages to blindfold himself with, and says that he can give you easy answers to life's complex questions, or talk to the dead, we will flock to hear that kind of thing. It's part of our nature, our need to have answers given to us, and it is inescapable.
Your mind has only, the only free will it's got is to choose ego thoughts, which are multitude, all separating, all different, all, but really they're all the same.
What are you for one reason? To stop you from making a terrible mistake.
They're just keeping you from acknowledging and recognizing the guilt.
People's need to protect their own egos knows no bounds. They will lie, cheat, steal, kill, do whatever it takes to maintain what we call ego boundaries.
I really didn't expect a haircut to be able to upset me as much as it did. I didn't really think I was that vain or had kind of got over that, but that this particular haircut is a military haircut.
Fighting man's haircut.
Looked like I was just entering boot camp. I could spend the next 8 months mad at this guy waiting for my hair to come back. I mean, for 2 weeks, I was getting upset. I was having all these kind of visions and stuff, concentration camps, having my head shaved, you know, going into the military, all sorts of sort of disgusting images, really, or horrible things. A lot of these images that kept coming up weren't images that I really wanted to think about too much, so I'd hand them over as quickly as possible. So the way I see it is that ego is attacking and Holy Spirit is using the opportunity to forgive or to hand over, for me to hand over and for it to erase and reformat those sectors of my mind that have been corrupted in past dream games or even this dream game in terms of my opinion about military people and haircuts and war and fighting and all the rest.
What's your unconscious bias? And some said, intelligence. When I look at somebody, depending on how they present themselves, I will judge whether they're as intelligent as me, more intelligent than me, less intelligent than me. My bias might be tall people. And in fact, in society, there have been many studies that have shown that tall people are perceived to be more powerful, therefore, the leader of the group.
So what I want to do is I want to share three things that I learned from this particular experience and how I have applied them in terms of how it is that I relate to the world day in and day out. One of those is, I call it rejecting the label. And you see this a lot in the media out there. The label is basically, I slip into accepting labels when I become intellectually lazy and I want to label people based on their perspective or their point of view. Right winger, limo liberal.
Not only do we all do it, but when we do it, remember those social data trails that are feeding the algorithms, that are feeding the prediction of what we like in terms of our movies, in terms of our purchases, in terms of our mates, right? We are feeding those things using our social trails, the little crumbs of our texts, of our tweets, of our Instagram photos, all the details that we don't think about because it's automatic and it's easy and it's quick and it's fun. So we're spreading our unconscious biases every single time we communicate. And therefore, we're training, like we train our children, the algorithms and the artificial intelligence bots with those biases. And again, they're serving us the predictions and they're serving us the movies, and they're saying that more and more, right? Different fields will become automated, and we will have more customized services based on our preferences. But if our preferences aren't actually based on what we believe in, but rather what we've bought into, that's a really scary self-perpetuating circle.
You know, why do we do that? Why do we label? That's the drunken monkey at work. Because instead of diving in to a complicated issue and trying to figure out the nuances, we want some easy way we can grab onto it and say, I get it. I understand that person. I know what they do and why they're doing it. So I've worked hard to reject the label, to work to understand the situation, to accept the facts, regardless of whether or not they line up with my personal beliefs.
Cognitive dissonance occurs when individuals lack consistency in their methods of thinking, and thus, contradictory elements attempting to reside simultaneously as fact create frustration, confusion, anger, and aggression. It is the difference between what you think the world is and what the world actually is.
You think that what you were taught in public schooling during that 15,000 hours is really what's going on. And it's not until you bump up against reality, as George Orwell said, usually on a battlefield, that you have to consider that which you were taught to believe versus the objective evidence that exists.
realizing that we have the ability to control our way of thinking in a seemingly chaotic world is the most transformative and empowering human experience that we possess. Use it on a daily basis, and you will change your life and the world around you in many wonderful ways. Thank you.
One of the good things about this hoop practice and bringing things to peace is I don't have to spend all this time thinking about or reliving the experience. As soon as I realize I'm upset, I just hand it over. I don't have to wander around thinking I'm in a concentration camp for the next 2 days, dwelling in the upset to try and get to the root of it all. I will never know the root of it all. That's the way the ego operates. We don't know the source of most of the upsets. Of Course in Miracles just simply tells us every upset is an unconscious reminder I'm not at home in peace. It's about the separation from God. Well, I got separated from my hair. I got separated from a great deal of my dignity, or that's how it felt at the time. The upsets pretty much have gone away now. I'm not really very upset about this. It's slowly filling out. I mean, I don't really like looking like a toilet brush, but we'll get there. You know, this is, again, it's part of the upset. Perhaps some of you might want to look into your mind and see how it would affect you if somebody shaved your head without your consent.
So what is this collective bias that we have, all of us? Right? Why is it that I've been fighting against the idea of living in a man's world, and yet I'm perpetuating it by hiding from the consequences of being attractive? That makes no sense. What am I doing? And so I have no real answers for you. And I'm all the more embarrassed that because I work using social data and artificial intelligence, and that I do sit in the boardrooms, and that I write thought leadership articles for large corporations that, you know, get inspired, and that it makes them act in certain ways, which affects all of us, because multinationals, whether we like it or not, affect all of us. What have I been doing? Well, again, on the good side, this is wonderful. It has pushed me to try to surpass myself. And on the negative side, I've perpetuated so many unconscious biases throughout my career that I'll never be able to see the repercussions of them because I don't know what they are. So I spend all of this time investing in those ideas and acting upon them, and yet somebody who knows me incredibly well put a light on something that I was completely blind to, my own conscious or unconscious bias.
Blinded by the light, wrapped up like a douche, another runner in the night. Blinded by the light, wrapped up like a douche, another runner in the night.
lesson I've learned from the haircut too. I'm no longer under suspicion from my wrong mind. My wrong mind is now vicious. This was ego attacking me. Holy Spirit isn't going to make me suffer. His job is to relieve me of the suffering. I mean, I don't mean to sound special, and it's going to become more like that for you. Once there's no suspicion anymore, ego isn't suspicious of me now. It knows I want peace and I'm not messing about. So the power supply is drying up and ego knows. So it has to attack me in every way it can. And as a network, it has access to everybody else's mind. And if they're weak, they're easy to overcome and to do things. I mean, the guy clearly knew he'd done it wrong. He just didn't understand how he'd done it wrong. He probably just completely went unconscious for those zip, 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 zip few moments. Ego wants me upset all the time because then I'm feeding the program. But, and that was, that attack was a long-term energy supply. That was going to be a good repeat offender.
I don't want to be here.
Come on, Tycho. You just got a bad case of first-time user anxiety.
I don't like it here. I don't know what's going on. We're both stumbling around together in this unformed world whose rules and objectives are largely unknown, seemingly indecipherable, or even possibly non-existent, always on the verge of being killed by forces that we don't understand.
It sounds like my game, all right.
It sounds like a game. It's not going to be easy to market.
But it's a game everybody's already playing.
Wherever you don't want to go is where you will find him. What is it that you're afraid of, Mr. Green?
Notice the better.
You know how I hate it when we argue.
Instant. You know, literally, as soon as you can find, as soon as you realize you're not at peace, hand it over.
I can hear you. What? I can hear you. I'm onto you.
The sooner you hand it over, everything changes. I mean, it may not, I mean, in your physical reality, it doesn't change immediately.
Listening to the other side, aren't you, Jake? Listening to people that want to hurt you, Jake.
New people. New!
Not old friends like me. People you shouldn't trust.
The best pals, Jake!
You want to get rid of me?
You know life without me?
You don't know life without me.
Do you know life without me? No! Because it doesn't exist.
Get rid of them, Jake. So to train your mind away from this inside-out, upside-down, back-to-front thought system that is the world's thought system, takes quite a lot of work.
I'm coming to get you.
You're aligning your mind with the Holy Spirit.
I just don't want
you
to get hurt.
Not with the ego. And it's that simple. It just isn't necessarily that easy.
Somebody has to tell you the truth.
Because you'll fight it.
It's doomed.
And the world is designed to keep you in the world, not to allow you to escape.
Get rid of them, Jake.
Forever.
They're the enemy, not me.
They're new. I'm old. I stay, they go. I say, you do.
You're weak without me. Weak. It's us against them, Jake. It's us against them. I'm coming to get you.
You want to get rid of me, do ya? Do ya?
You want to get rid of me?
Me?
Boom. Ha.
There is no such thing as an external enemy, no matter what that voice in your head is telling you. All perception of an enemy is a projection of the ego as the enemy.
It's doomed.
It's going to rally its forces to keep you here.
Somebody has to tell you the truth.
So if you think it's all going to become very easy very quickly...
I just don't want you to get hurt.
I don't have good news for you in that regard.
You know how I hate
it's
when we
get
argue.
Worse before it gets better.
Still here, Jake.
You can't win this one without me. Oh, no. You know why? I am you. You ain't me.
The greatest con that he ever pulled was making you believe that he is you.
You ain't me.
I am you!
You're not me.
Come on! Your best fucking friend! I am you!
To be clear here, it wasn't Holy Spirit that inspired Barber to shave my head so that I could get the lessons. Ego is attacking me. It will attack everybody. It's attacking us all the time. Just most of us don't think that attack is anything out of the normal. And it isn't. It's perfectly normal. 50,000 a day. You're not good enough, you can't do that, you're not enough, you need this to be better, you need other people, you've got to have this, you need love to cast out this, you need to do that, blah, 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 blah. Negative, limiting. I can't stop those 50,000. That's how ego controls us. It's that voice that's telling us what to do. It doesn't stop. All I can do is choose to think another way. I can decide against what it's telling me and think with Holy Spirit. I can go to peace. But that's my only option. You know, I can think of another thing to do, or I can...
Checkmate. He's all up here. Pretending to be you.
You're not gonna outwit it. You're not, it's far more devious and cunning and vicious and spiteful and vindictive than I even really want to contemplate. But again, that has to be dealt with. You have to see where the motivation's coming from and what you're choosing for or what you're choosing against.
Believe me. You'll only be humiliated.
You can lie, you can cheat, you can twist, but you will never teach the devil no tricks.
I'm sorry. Somebody has to tell you the truth.
Stuff that you'll be looking at in yourself that you won't want to look at. You really won't. It's horrible, you know? It's the depths of depravity, but it's inside all of us because it's in ego.
Leonard. Oh, Leonard.
What did you do to Bonnie Norell?
Bonnie?
Ever since she went out with you, she's been listless, uncommunicative. Suddenly she becomes nauseated at the smell of scrub pine.
Oh.
She was doing so well. What happened?
Well, all I did is tell her that she couldn't possibly have any feelings for me. Well, that she just liked me on account of I was a shaman in training.
Wait. You mean Bonnie told you she had feelings for you?
Uh-huh.
And you told her that was impossible?
Right.
Oh. Maybe it's my fault. Maybe I pushed you into this too soon. Are you expecting company?
Green man.
A green man.
He said he was going to join me for dinner and the rest of my life.
Now it all makes sense.
Does?
Ed, have you ever heard of low self-esteem? That's what the green man is. I know they've entered our mythology as something akin to gremlins, but they're really a manifestation of poor self-image. A sense of inadequacy.
I'm not sure I follow you, Leonard.
You have a terrible self-image. That's why you said those absurd, stupid things to Bonnie. They have no relation to objective reality. You're an eminently lovable person, Ed. The truth is, you created this green man. He's the embodiment of your own self-loathing. I tell you something, Ed, this is your demon.
My demon?
Everyone who's chosen to be a shaman has a demon to fight. And yours is the worst of all. Low self-esteem is the root cause of practically all the pain and misery in the world. It's what drives war and torture and genocide. It's what evil is. You think Hitler liked himself? Or Cortez? We hate others because we hate ourselves. You can't be a healer, Ed, as long as the green man owns you.
How do I get rid of him, Leonard?
I'm afraid you can't. Not entirely. But you can keep him at bay. And there's only one way to do that. It's actually put very well in the Christian gospel. John 1. Love casts out fear. You have to learn to love yourself. Good night, Ed.
Love casts out fear. Wrong mind interprets this to mean love from outside me casts out my fear so I can be in love. I think another way. Love projects out fear. Love inside me projects out my fear so I can bring it to peace. Any thoughts in my mind that aren't loving will always be rejected as not love by my right mind and projected out. So what I'm experiencing in my conscious mind are these projections of not love or fear that are in a sense being reflected back at me from my unconscious mind. I experience an outside projection of the inside condition of my mind. I would simply see this projected fear for the illusion it is and release it in an instant. But UReGO has tricked me into thinking these projections of fear are who I am, and that I need love to make me enough to be able to cast out this fear. By turning my thinking inside out, UReGO has me looking outside myself for the love inside. Upside down thinking has me comparing every experience unfavorably to some ideal love experience. And back to front thinking tells me that I didn't find love in the past and I won't find love in the future. Thinking like this puts me on the seek and do not find merry-go-round and a lifetime of upsets. But at least if I'm suffering for love, I can't be blamed for not trying.
Blamed for not trying.
Fear and love are the only two emotions of which I am capable. This tells me that the fear I think is inside me and the love UReGO has programmed me to think is outside are both inside me. My mind has been split, but both love and fear are inside my mind. It's all in my mind. The basic conflict between love and fear is unconscious. This is the basic good versus evil conflict, where love casts out fear. The conflict where the love inside me is casting out or projecting the fear in my unconscious into my conscious experience in order for me to choose to come to peace with this upset or not. So while the unconscious conflict between love and fear is the cause of my upset, what I actually consciously experience as the effect of this conflict are my worries and regrets, both coming with their various attached body stresses, providing me with a wide range of seemingly different upsetting experiences, all of which are designed to distract me from the thought of peace. The only place from which I can express the love inside me. Right now, in the present, the expression of love can be experienced, and it's experienced as joy and happiness. This is what the reality remind does. When I choose to, it brings my upset mind to peace of mind at will. I simply flick the switch from wrong mind to right mind. I shift my perspective from experiencing a situation to being peacefully aware of the situation.
In the battle.
Or above the battleground. This is all done by me in my conscious mind when I notice and decide and I'm willing to be in peace of mind right now. Behind the walls of my box, so I don't worry about this conflict anymore. I can stop looking for love outside myself. I can stop trying to get love from other people or things. And I can stop stressing out about unconscious fear I can't control. Love and fear I leave to Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit can work in my unconscious. I can't. My upsets must be brought to peace where they are experienced. So the conflict I'm concerned about is not between love and fear, but the conflicts I experience every day on the walls of my box. The conflicts going on in my conscious mind, moment to moment. This is where I experience the cognitive dissonance fueling my upsets, as I compare my ideal right mind's thoughts of joy and happiness to my actual experience of wrong mind's thoughts of worry and regret. This is the conflict I'm experiencing in my box every time I get upset. And it's here in my box where the upset must be brought to peace. Thinking steps one and two has disabled UReGO's distraction programming. There's nothing to analyze and nothing to decide. So now it all comes down to one simple choice. Am I willing for peace, Joy?
You're going. Those for me?
I don't want to talk to you.
Uh-oh. This is about last night. I'm sorry. I stood you up. Look, some old college friends came by. We made sangria. I lost track of time. Look, Ed, I'm only here for one reason. To stop you from making a terrible mistake.
What do you mean?
What could she possibly ever see in you? She comes from a good family. She's going to college. She's cultured. Ed. You're nothing but a poor, uneducated orphan. You're totally beneath her. And even if by some chance you did get together, it's doomed. Sooner or later, she'd grow to hate you. Didn't you ever see the movie, Blue Angel?
Marlene Dietrich?
Remember? Emil Jennings plays this pathetic weakling who marries her. Naturally, she grows to despise him. And how does that end?
He kills himself.
Ed, I'm sorry. Somebody has to tell you the truth. I just don't want you to get hurt. You understand?
No, I'm not going to listen to you.
What, Ed? Wait, don't you believe me? You'll only be humiliated. Ed, oh God, Ed, wait, please. Ed, please. What's gonna happen to me? What happens to me, Ed? Ed!
Hi. These are for you.
Thanks.
Bonnie?
Yeah?
There's something I'd like to explain to you.
Okay. Come on in.
once to write a love song, an anthem of forgiving, a manual for living with defeat. A cry above the suffering, a sacrifice recovering, but that isn't what I need him to complete. Doesn't have a burden, that he doesn't need a vision, that he only has permission to do my instant bidding, which is to say what I have told him to repeat. That he doesn't need a vision, that he only has permission to do my instant bidding, which is to say what I have told him to repeat. Going home without my